you to benefit from everything you are hearing. We started last night and the Lord has been speaking to our hearts. And he comes to speak to us, now teaching us his word, revealing his mind to us, that you pray that God will help you to understand and perceive and be able to be the doers of the word. Raise your voice to the Lord and say, Lord, I want to be a doer of that word. I want to receive. Give me understanding. Give me insight into the word. And the insight to give me your word, I'll be able to live by it. Be a kind of minister the Lord is raising up, a kind of church the Lord is raising up today. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord and say, Lord, do this in me. Reveal your mind to me and make me do of the word. Receive the word in your heart, your soul, your spirit. Discover why you're here, why the Lord has sent you here, and be willing to accept and receive and believe and live by the totality of the word is revealing to you that God in his love, God in his grace, God in his mercy will make you a true minister and make the church where pastor, the true church, Christian church of the living God, and the marks of a real true Christian minister the Lord will produce, that mark in your life and the marks of a true Christian church, the Lord will produce it in your life as well. This new year, new life, new attitude, new vitality for the church, new strength and new power, new understanding, new focus, new vision, new revelation, that God will look at his church and be happy that this is what the sacrifice of Christ has produced. And that your presence in the church, your participation in the church, will keep the church righteous, godly, holy, sanctified, a true Christian church. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God said, Amen. Our Father, we thank you once again. We bless your name. Thank you, Lord, for how you've raised up a church like this. Thank you, Lord, for making us part of a church like this. We pray, oh Lord, all that you want us to be, all that you want us to do, all you want us to contribute to make the church a true Christian church, help us, Lord, to be willing and faithful and to do it in Jesus' name. We come again before your word and we're going to read your word. Lord, we pray as we hear your voice through the servant you are going to use, Lord, we pray that we respond to that word appropriately in Jesus' name. Be glorified in every life, every family, and every local church and the old church together in Jesus' name. Speak, for your servants are hearing. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much. You can sit down. We're talking about the church. We're talking about the Christian church. We're talking about the true Christian church. How do you recognize a true Christian church? How do you identify a true Christian church? What are the marks? What are the characteristics? What are you looking for? Number one, if you're going to be part of a church and you say, my heart is yearning, my heart is looking for a true Christian church, if I see one, I want to be part of that. What are the marks and what are the characteristics or maybe you want to be a minister, or you're a minister already, and you're saying, I want to spend my resources, my life, I want to give my talent, my skill, everything I've got, I want to give that to raising up a true Christian church. What are you looking for? What is it you'll be able to say? These are the marks, these are the characteristics, and this is the evidence of a true Christian church. And when I'm used of God, a part of the church, and I contribute to that, then I'll feel fulfilled and satisfied that I've accomplished something. That's why we're looking at the true Christian church, and we're looking at the marks and the evidence and the characteristics of that true Christian church. I'm looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. And I'm reading from verse 37 all through to verse 47. And you're going to see here the traits and the marks and the characteristics and the evidence of a true Christian church. It says in Acts chapter 2, verse 37, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? They had just heard the word of God, the message of life. And Peter spoke the word without fear, without favor. He spoke the word without cringing, without any cowardice. He spoke the word with conviction and courage. He laid it on them. He said, you are the one that crucified the Lord. And then they said, now we have realized the guilt. We have realized the condemnation. We have realized the weight of our sin. What shall we do, men and brethren? What shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, for the remission, removal, forgiveness of your sins. And then he says, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Some people will say, Christ has done it all. All you need to do is raise up your hand and say, yes, I believe. Yes, I believe. I believe that Jesus Christ is this or that. It's more than that. It says, repent. That is to turn away, look at your life, and look at everything that is dirty and defiled in the sight of the Lord, and turn around, and turn away from all those sins. It says, repent, and then you receive the gift of salvation, and the gift of his grace, and the gift of his love, and the gift of his son, and the gift of the Holy Ghost as well, for the promises unto you. The promise of salvation is unto you, of sanctification is unto you, of the baptism and the power of the Holy Ghost is unto you. The gift, every gift we're having from God, every gift is unto you and to your children, and to as many as those who are far away or far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words, applying the word to them and telling them, this is the way you have gone astray. You see those preachers of those days, they were not trying to perch people, entice people, motivate people, just make people happy. They told them the reality of the word, how they need to separate from their past sins and then come clean and come clear unto the Lord. They were not trying to just make them happy in their sins. With many other words, they testify unto them, saying, save yourself, rescue yourself, separate yourself, withdraw yourself from this unto an evil generation. Then it says, they that received his word with gladness. They gladly received the word. They were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them, how many people? About 3,000 souls. And look at the kind of message that brought them unto the Lord. They spelled out sin very well and told them, if you're going to be saved, if you're going to know the benefit of the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, come out that you may come in, out of darkness into his light, out of all the degradation and defilement of the past into his own desire, and out of all the evil things that you have done, out of your sin, you come to the righteousness of the Lord. And it says, gladly, joyfully, happily, cheerfully, they received the word, and there were 3,000 people. Then it says, and they continued the day. That's the church. Those who are saved, that's the church. Those who realize we're no more of this world, we're bound to Christ, that's the church. Those who understand we're pilgrims and we're strangers in this world, that's the church. Those who are cleansed from their sins, those who are washed from their defilement, that's the church. Those who abandon their past evil life and they come to the Lord born again and saved and became new creatures in Christ, That is the church. And the people that remain, the people who abide, not the people that came to crusade, they came to church, they came to a covenant service of the new year, and then they raise up their hands, they're so happy, this new year God is going to give us this and give us, not that. The people that gladly receive the word of repentance, the word of righteousness, and the word of holiness, and the word of separating from the world, those are, that's the church. Those are the people they continue steadfastly. Not just, you know, we have to be begging them, putting pressure on them, following them up, running after them, knocking at their doors. But on their own, they came and joyfully they remained steadfastly. They were in prayer and they were in fellowship and to the apostles' doctrine. These were not people that were pleading with the apostles, change the doctrine. That's not the church. They were not pleading with the apostles, modify the doctrine. That's not the church. They were not pleading with the apostles, this is hard and this is tough. We can bear this one. You're telling us to forsake Moses and forsake the law, forsake all those ceremonies and then come clean and come clear and make Jesus Christ the only Lord and Master of your life, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. That's too tough. Give us chance and do it slowly. If we're even going to do that, why don't you graduate, make it gradually, little bit. Not that people, not the people who are saying that they don't want to follow the word of God. Those people that saw the doctrine of the word and it says steadfastly with all their heart, all their soul, all their mind, they were going to follow the word of God without modification. That is the church. Anything less than that, anything that, you know, we gather crowds together, gather people together, you have to inject them, you have to motivate them, you have to make them happy, you have to give them some intoxicating kind of motivation before they can move on. That's not the church. The people that steadfastly continued with the word, that is the church, and that is what this church is going to be in Jesus' name. And then it says, they continue the apostles' doctrine, and they continue in fellowship, and they continue the breaking of bread, and then it says in prayers, and fear came upon every soul. Fear came upon every soul. Not the people that don't fear God, the people that do not recognize the authority of God and the power of God. They do not recognize the justice and the judgment of God, but the people that fear God, and now they're living their lives in the fear of, oh, no, I can't do that. God will not approve of that. I can't say that. God will not approve of that. I can't go there. God will not approve of that. The people that had the fear of God, and it says, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all that believed were together. We need to hear of high and low, among them rich and poor, among them educated and illiterate, among them IFL and the unfortunate, among them everybody, they were all together. When you say this one is having this little standard, that one is having that standard, these ones are rich, be gentle with them, these ones, they are illiterate, so you can do anything with them, this one are coming from overseas, you know, this one they believe, this one they are coming from the village, and this one they believe. No, they were all together. That is the church. We're not talking about a kind of congregation, amalgamated all these people together. That one is that class and that one is that class. You can't preach the truth to that class. You cannot preach a sanctification to that class. You can't preach a restitution to this other class. You cannot preach a living right and living clean to this other class. And those other, be very careful. You can't talk to them or that. They were all together and they believe the same thing, the same word of God. That is the church. And if this church is going to remain a Bible church, a New Testament church, a Christian church, a true Christian church, we're all going to come back together. We're going to say that this is the word for everybody, and we're going to stand on that word for everybody in Jesus' name. It's not like, you know, we are women, we have this women's section, and whatever they are saying over there, this is what you accept, this is what you will not accept. Another person, we are the rich people, we are the financiers of this church. If they don't count on us and make sure that they tailor the message according to what we like, well, the church is going to remain in their little ramshackle kind of thing. Not that. The people that were all together and they stood for the same thing and they believed the same thing and they were going to hold on to the same thing forever until the end of their lives. That's the kind of church you have in the New Testament. And that is the kind of church we're going to have in this place in Jesus' name. It says, I thought you would say a good amen to that. Are you the one you want modification? I said, you want modification? I want it, you know, this the day of civilization, technology, and the day of this and that. Let's tone it down. You'll tone it down. I'm sure you will not, and I'm going to do that until I leave. If Jesus dies, we're going to maintain this same Bible standard till the end of our lives in Jesus' name. And if Jesus tarries and I'm gone, whoever is there that takes over, I hope the rest of you will be watching. You'll be watching them. Anybody that takes over from me, and then you say, well, the man is gone. You know, that fiery fellow is gone. The one that keeps every jot and every tittle of the Bible, that one is gone. The one that wants to keep everything in the 20th century, 21st century, he wants to still keep everything. He is gone. I am the one here now. If anybody rises up, the rest of us, all of you remain. I'll be looking at you from heaven. And if I go to heaven before, I'll be looking down there at your congresses, at your retreats, and I'll say, I'm going to see. I'm not going to take rest when I get over there. If I go there before you, I'm going to ask permission from Lord. Let me be watching them. What are they going to do with the message of the word after I'm gone? But the person who is there, and you understand the people that are, we have authority, because you know, when we get over there, we can talk directly to the Lord. We can talk directly to the Lord Almighty and say, and I'll say, if I'm over there and then somebody comes in and he says, well, the fellow is gone, I tell you, I'm not gone. Moses came back to that mountain of resurrection, and Elijah came back to that mountain of transfiguration. I'll tell the Lord to remove him. He will remove that person. Because this word, we're going to keep it to the very end in Jesus' name. The true church, the rapturable church, the righteous church, the church that Jesus Christ died for, the marks and the evidence and the characteristics that the Lord is looking for, we're going to find it in this church. That in every village church, in every city church, in every locality there, in every country where we have this church represented, this Bible in our hand from cover to cover, by the grace of God, in the strength and the might of the Holy Ghost, we're going to keep to it in Jesus' name. And while I am alive, let me tell you, if there is anyone out there, anyone, any section of the church, if I have authority at all, I have authority in prayer. If I have anointing at all, I have anointing in prayer. If we cannot touch you, you know, some people, you cannot move them. If we talk to you, we try to say, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that way? And you're not, and you say, no, I'm not bold. You do whatever you do. Where be God we can talk to? When we cannot handle you, I will pray. Oh God, you see what we're sacrificing for. You see the kind of church we're raising up, because this is your commandment. This is the commission you have given us. And then we've told him, do it this way. He said, no. And then he has all these people around him that we cannot do anything. I say, God, remove him, because I cannot do it anymore. And you can do it. God will remove that person, even while I'm still alive. Because this church will stand on this eternal truth, and nothing will change this truth in our hand in Jesus' name. Do you see why we're here? Who wants to waste his time here? You want to just stay here and waste your time and waste your life? Life is so short, and he called us for something. And that thing he has called us for, we're going to stand on it in Jesus' name. What are we doing? We just finished a retreat, and then we labored and prayed from morning till evening, one message, the other message again. Then we came the following day, one message, another message again. And then we finished that, the watch night service, we preach again. And then Sunday we preached again, that preaching all the time. Who wants to waste his life if there is no Christian church? Who wants to waste his life if the truth of the word is not with us? I'm not into religion. Are you into religion? Why the Lord has brought us here, why the Lord has brought you here, so that the marks of the true Christian church and the marks and the evidence of the church of the New Testament, the Lord will raise it up in us. He's going to use every one of us to do that in Jesus' name. I didn't come here to entertain anybody. Congress is not for entertainment. Congress is not for clapping hands. Congress is not to give you some motivation. I'm not here to motivate. Motivational speakers are out there.